Hello guys, today we are going to discuss the practical estimation of phosphorus by Fiske-Suvorov method. In this, we are going to estimate the phosphorus present in the biological sample. So here before to that, how phosphorus is related to the human body that we are going to discuss. The total phosphorus present is in the 1 kg in the total body mass approximately, where it will be the abundant mineral which is going to be formed in many biological molecules. So it is going to form 80% present in the whatever the bones and the teeth as the hydroxyapatite, like calcium, phosphorus and hydrogen or oxygen. It is naturally occurring form of the mineral. So this complex is going to occur naturally, where it is going to form calcium apatite, where calcium, phosphorus and oxygen are going to form the hexagonal crystals in bone, where the bone is the dynamic tissue that is constantly undergoing osteoclastic bone resorption and osteoblastic bone formation, where the bones are going to be the structural support of the body. So here the presence of the phosphorus is very very critical in the form of the hydroxyapatite with the calcium and oxygen and the hydrogen, where calcium, phosphorus and oxygen are going to be the main minerals or the togetherly going to form the compound as the hydroxyapatite. So it is also involved in the release of the energy from fat. So the phosphorus is responsible for the metabolic release of the energy from fat and protein, carbohydrate during metabolism. And the formation of the genetic material will be in the presence of the phosphorus. And cell membranes are also going to have phosphorus, and many enzymes are going to have the phosphorus. So totally to the major biomolecules which are present in our body, like the bones or the proteins or the genetic material and the cell membranes and the enzymes, which are very much responsible for metabolic activities, are going to have phosphorus as one of their ingredients. And nucleic acid nucleotides like ATP, GTP, ADP, etc. are also going to have the phosphorus, which we have discussed here again. Normal values of phosphorus in adult is 2.5 to 4.5 milligram per deciliter. Infants are going to have 4.5 to 8 milligrams per deciliter, and the child is going to have 4 to 6 milligram per deciliter. And the principle goes like this, where we are going to treat the phosphate compound, where we consider it as the phosphorus, with the acid molybdate, where it is going to give the phosphomolybdate form. And again, it is going where we are going to treat this phosphomolybdate with ANSA reagent, where it is going to give a blue color complex. Now here, this is the equation. Now after getting the blue complex, we are going to read it using a red filter at 640 nanometer. Now coming to the next slide, in this slide we are going to discuss the reagents required. The reagents required are the 10% TCA, ammonium molybdate acid, acidic form, and ANSA reagent, and the standard phosphate stock solution and working phosphate standard. So here these are the reagents required. Now when you are going to consider TCA, we are going to prepare according to whatever has been given, where we are going to prepare 100% weight per volume solution by dissolving 2.2 grams of TCA in 1 ml of H2O. Then prepare a 10% solution by adding 0.1 ml of 100% TCA solution to 0.9 ml of distilled water. So keep both solutions ice cold. So in this form you can prepare any amount of the TCA which is required to your lab. And again is ammonium molybdate, where we are going to prepare this ammonium molybdate in the acidic form, where we are going to consider 139 ml of concentrated sulfuric acid, where it will be slowly poured to 36 ml of distilled water. So it gives 10 normal sulfuric acid, 10 normality sulfuric acid. Now we are going to dissolve 12.5 grams of ammonium molybdate in 10 normality sulfuric acid, and the mixture is made up to 500 ml with 10 normality sulfuric acid. So this is how we are going to make the acidic ammonium molybdate. Answer reagent is like we have made it into three parts. See here these dots which has been separated with colors. First is we are going to dissolve 10 grams of sodium metabisulfite in 250 ml of distilled water. Next is we are going to separately dissolve 20 grams of sodium sulfate to 100 ml of distilled water. Now we are going to add 0.5 milligrams of ANSA. It is the pure ANSA in 195 ml of sodium metabisulfate. Now here from this we are going to take 195 ml of sodium metabisulfate and we are going to add 0.5 milligrams of ANSA. To the above mixture add 5 ml of sodium sulfate. From this second reagent what we have prepared, we are going to add 5 ml of sodium sulfate, then mix thoroughly to get a clear solution. If solution is not clear, then the solution is heated and cooled and add 0.5 ml of sodium sulfate, and if then the solution is going to become clear, we are going to store in a brown bottle. Again we have to prepare standard phosphate stock solution, where we are going to take 87.75 milligrams of mono potassium phosphate, where it will be weighed and dissolved in 100 ml distilled water and make up the volume to 250 ml in standard flask with distilled water. So this is how the standard phosphate stock solution is prepared. Further, working phosphate solution is we are going to take 10 ml from this stock standard phosphate stock solution and we are going to make it to 100 ml with distilled water. So here one more thing, as per your requirements at your lab, that it be in the college or your R&D labs, you can make the calculation according to your lab and you can make use of the preparation of these chemicals. Now in this slide we are going to prepare the protein free biosample. There can be two biosamples, one can be from the blood serum and other can be the urine. So here both biosamples can be taken for the estimation of the phosphorus or the phosphate. Here we have to take the sample, but we have to avoid the hemolysis, the breaking of the hemoglobin, because it is going to contain around 40 milligram per deciliter of the phosphorus. So for the estimation it will be very good. Sample is stable for several days at 4 degree centigrade. So when you're going to prepare this sample, you're going to prepare, after preparation the sample is going to be for the several days at 4 degree centigrade, where you are going to process this for the protein free procedure, where you are going to take 1:9 volumes of ice cold 100% TCA to the serum sample. So one volume will be of the ice cold TCA, 9 volumes will be of this sample, and further you are going to place on ice for 10 minutes after adding the TCA of one part, and further you are going to add 500 microliters of ice cold 10% TCA to the sample. So further you are going to do the 20 minutes of the incubation on ice. Centrifuge you are going to do at 5000 rpm for 20 minutes. After centrifugation you remove the precipitate and retain the supernatant. Precipitate is going to have the proteins. TCA is the reactant which is going to precipitate the protein, hence the precipitate is going to have the proteins, and whatever the supernatant is going to have the remaining ingredients of the blood serum. To estimate the phosphorus, use the supernatant as the unknown sample. So within the supernatant there will be the phosphorus released from the blood, hence the supernatant can be used to estimate the phosphorus as unknown sample, because we doesn't know what amount of the phosphorus is present in the serum. Further is the urine sample. You have to collect 42 hours samples, in the sense within 42 hours the sample has to be taken and it has to be stored in the acid washed detergent free containers. And again we are going to acidify with HCl after collection. So further, it is going to be stable for 6 months. So the samples are going to be stable for 6 months when you are going to acidify with HCl with a few drops of the HCl. Further, for urine, dilute urine at 1:10 with distilled water and prepare protein free filtrate the same way as for serum. When you are going to subject the sample, you are going to subject by dilution, with the help of the dilution, and you are going to take it into the protein free filtrate form similar to here, and you are going to subject into the estimation of the phosphorus. Now here also, when you are going to avoid hemolysis and you are going to keep the container with a particular anticoagulant, you can store it for several days. Here it can be 6 months. So that is the difference. Now next is procedure. Here the procedure, this is the procedure where this same procedure we are going to discuss in this protocol. Here we are going to take around 6 tubes for the blank and the reference standard, and the 2 tubes for the unknown sample. Now here the blank will be as usual, it is going to contain around 0 volume of the phosphorus, there will be nothing here. And the first test tube of the reference will be 0.5 ml of phosphorus, 1 ml of the phosphorus solution, 1.5 ml of the phosphorus solution, 2 ml, 2.5 ml of the phosphorus solution. And these standard references are going to have the corresponding microgram of the phosphorus per ml as 20 microgram per 2.5 ml. And unknown samples, what we are going to take is 0.5 ml and 0.5 ml. Again here unknown samples, we doesn't know what micrograms of the ml of the phosphorus is present here. So here in this unknown samples, either you can take the standard serum or the urine as per your preference. Further is amount of distilled water in ml. So we are going to make up this particular volumes to the 4.3 as the total volume. Either you can make 4.5 also. So here, as we are done in our labs, we are done 4.3 ml. Here, as this test tube is going to be the blank, here we are taking the total volume of 4.3. Here, we are going to taking the rest of the volume of the 0.5, that is 3.5 ml of the distilled water. Like this, 3.3 here, 2.8 here, 2.3 here, 1.8 here, again here, 3.8 and 3.8. Okay, it's a typo error as 4.3. Here it is 3.8 and 3.8. So the each test tube is going to have, all the test tubes are going to have 4.3 as their final volume at this stage of the experiment. Further is, you are going to add 0.5 ml of the ammonium molybdate to each of the test tubes, to all these test tubes with 4.3 volume of the solution. You are going to add 0.5 ml of the ammonium molybdate to each of the test tube and you are going to shake it well. Further, you are going to add 0.2 ml of the ANSA reagent to each of the test tubes. After the addition of the ammonium molybdate, you are going to add the ANSA reagent to all the test tubes. So here with this, each test tube is going to have 5 ml of the total volume of the solution. So here you are going to add this ANSA reagent and you are going to shake it well, and you are going to observe the development of the blue color complex. So here After the development of the blue color complex, you are going to read it at 460 nanometer with red filter. 640 nanometer, not 460 nanometer. You are going to read the absorbance at 640 nanometer with red filter, which is particularly used for the wavelength of 630 to 750 nanometer. Now here, whatever the absorbance we got is 0.09182060745070707. So this is what the absorbance after the decimal we got it. Now further, we are going to subject this in the graph. Here in the graph, we are going to consider the amount of the phosphorus present and what the absorbance we got. According to these values, you can see at the 4 micrograms at this position, 0.09 is the absorbance. At the 8 micrograms, you can see 0.18. At the 12 micrograms, it is 0.26. At the 16 micrograms, it is 0.37. And at the 20 micrograms, it is 0.45. So this is water. Now, when you are going to consider, this is the x-axis for the phosphorus in micrograms. This is the y-axis for the absorbance, which has been differenced between 0 to 0.5. Depending upon the values, what we are going to get after the OD or the absorbance which we are going to get. So here, the whatever the values we got here from blank to the 20 micrograms, from 0 to the 20 micrograms, whatever the absorbance we got, we had been subjected in the graph with the linear line curve. And whatever the unknown sample we got, that we have intersected here with the standard reference line curve, and we a perpendicular has been dropped, and we got around 3.2 micrograms of the phosphorus is present in this sample as per the 0.07, as per the 0.07 absorbance. Now you can observe here. So here a drop has been made and it is 3.2 micrograms. When you are going to come to the calculation part, as we got the 3.2 micrograms here, for the volume of 0.5 ml of the sample, so those we are going to subject in the calculation. 0.5 ml of the given solution contains around 3.2 micrograms of the phosphorus. Therefore, 100 ml of solution contains 3.2 divided by 0.5 into 100. Now, what the calculation has given is 640 micrograms or 0.64 micrograms of the phosphorus. Now, why you are taking this 0.5? 0.5 is in the denominator, it is the volume. In this volume, you are going to get this particular amount. If you are going to estimate for 1 ml, 1 will be the denominator. If you are going to estimate for the 2 ml, 2 will be the denominator, and you are going to multiply it by 100 to the total division of the amount of the phosphorus you got and to the volume to which we got the amount of the phosphorus. So here 640 micrograms or 0.6 micrograms of the phosphorus has been found. Now the normal value of the phosphorus, what we have discussed in the introduction, is like 2.5 to 4.5 milligram per deciliter to adult. Infant is going to have 4.5 to 8 milligrams deciliter, and the child is going to have 4 to 6 milligrams per deciliter. So according to this, when we are going to compare, this unknown sample is having only 640 micrograms or 0.64 milligrams, which is very very minute compared to this of phosphorus is found, where it is going to show that the concentration in blood or blood is very alarming. This was the result what we have got in our labs. Certainly in some college labs, they may use blood or they may use the samples which is self prepared from the phosphate compounds, and they can give them as the unknown samples. In some labs biochemistry labs, they are going to give the sample as the blood or the urine also. So depending upon that, the values can differ. Hence, while performing the experiment, please perform according to your labs, and you can follow this particular procedure of the Fiske-Subbaraw method, which has been concisely prepared by keeping in mind that the required things in absolute manner. If you are going to find any mistakes or any wrong explanation, please make sure to comment below, and if it is a good one, please appreciate us and share it, so it will be very helpful for us to grow with the other audience, like the students and the other persons who are keen to learn and understand from our channel of the Learner's Big Book. Thank you very much for watching.